Oké, okay, scheint te funktionieren. Also jetzt lege ich mal los, denke ich, mit dem experimentellen Vortrag. I think we should do this in English, right? Or what should we do? Either is fine, but I guess there's people here who prefer English, so let's do it in English. So, yeah, the title is Topological Insulator as a New State of Matter. Actually, what condensed matter people are doing these days is finding one new state of condensed matter after another. And basically, this came all because of a very venerable, old-fashioned semiconductor material, mercury telluride, which we happen to have available in Würzburg, and that we now are able to tune in all kinds of different configurations that actually are very different from what we thought about semiconductors before, but actually we seem to be doing the things that theorists in particle physics have been doing since the 80s or so. And so we're having a lot of fun with this, and I hope to show you a little bit of what's going on. So you will need to have some background in semiconductor physics. I apologize. I'll talk a bit about the band structure of mercury telluride and directly go and explain the quantum spin Hall effect in two-dimensional materials, or this is a two-dimensional topological insulator, we call it this these days. We can do it also in 3D, in thicker layers of mercury telluride. And then the recent development is going to topological superconductivity, where we deal with Majorana-bound states. So we really have a Majorana-bound state. And we can now try to play other tricks with that. And if there's some time left, I'll get into how we also can tweak our material into a Dirac system. So this is a slide that actually was given to me when I came to Würzburg by the people already working there. In Würzburg, they grow many different types of semiconductors in MBE systems on top of each other. And if you want to know what you can grow on top of another material, you have to know what materials have more or less the same lattice constant, because otherwise there's too much strain in the stack that you grow and things won't go very well. And so what you see here basically is these zinc blender semiconductors, which all have the same lattice structure. Here's the lattice constant, and here's the energy gap of the different material systems. And you see already that there's various families that line up. And these are the guys that you usually grow on top of each other, and then you can tweak the properties of your heterostructures. You also see that, well, if lattice constant gets larger, this, of course, is for semiconductors containing very heavy atoms. Mercury telluride is here, cadmium telluride is here. You also see that the overall lattice constant also goes down. You understand that because the atoms are further apart, there's less interaction. But there's something weird with mercury telluride, which we can actually grow on top of cadmium telluride, and that is that actually it has a negative band gap. This has been known for ages, but now we know this is where the fun is. This is the band structure of mercury telluride. This is an ancient type binding calculation, 1972, and we still believe this is more or less correct. The notable thing is this gamma 6 band here. So normally gamma 6, this is simply a symmetry inducing the type of band you have, is the conduction band in your zinc blender semiconductor, and it comes from unoccupied s electrons from the metal. Now in our case, the metal is mercury, and mercury is very heavy. And that means that these outer s electrons really move very, very fast, and there's an absolute energy correction, a relativistic energy correction to the absolute energy of this gamma 6 level. So normally the gamma 6 is somewhere here, but simply because of this relativistic effect, gamma 6 is lower in energy to below gamma 8, which you may know as the heavy hole, light hole duplet in your system. And that means, well, that's all there is to it, that actually there's an inversion, as we call it, in the band structure, and gamma 6 is now below gamma 8, and we have a negative energy gap. And what we now know is that if you have this type of band inversion between S and P type orbitals, as we have here, at an odd number of symmetry points, your material is a topological material. This is not an insulator yet, because if you start counting states, you see that the Fermi level still is at the gamma 8 duplet, so this is a topological semi-metal. And I'm a transport physicist. If you want to do transport, you have to have an insulator or at least something that doesn't give you background conductance. So you have to open up a gap in the gamma A duplet to see the effects of a topological insulator. And there's two easy ways to do it. And the easiest way from the beginning was to grow a quantum well. You may know that then the gamma 8 splits up in a heavy hole and a light hole state. And now it depends on how much confinement you give your system. And that's shown here. This is this quantum well of mercury telluride, where you have the inversion in the mercury telluride sandwich between mercury cadmium telluride, where the gamma 6 is already above the gamma 8. Now, if the quantum well is very wide, the confinement energy is small, and the states deriving from gamma 8, which we call an H state, is still higher in energy than the state deriving from gamma 6, which is an electron-like state, an E state. So these wide quantum wells have an inverted band structure and a band gap. So these are topological insulators. And we can actually tweak the band structure simply by changing the width of the quantum well. If you make your quantum well narrower, you add confinement energy, so the blue H state is pushed down and the red E state is pushed up. They overlap at a critical thickness, and for narrower quantum wells, you have a normal band structure. So we can really tweak this topological phase transition simply by changing the width of your quantum well. Now, why does this lead to a quantum spin Hall effect? Well, you can look at this in very, very many ways. This is kind of a hand-waving argument, which is more or less okay, I guess. This is an introductory slide that actually I borrowed from Charlie Kane. This is the way we look at insulators these days. Up to 1980, say, an insulator for a condensed matter physicist was a boring thing. You had electrons surrounding atomic cores. You had bands, and the valence band was all filled up, and the conduction band was empty. And if the Fermi level is in the energy gap, well, you have an insulator and nothing interesting happens, at least not if you're a transport physicist. Now, this changed big time with the discovery in 1980 by Klaus von Klitzing of the quantum Hall effect. Now, not everybody looks at the quantum Hall effect as something to do with insulators, but you can certainly do so. So what you have, if you take a two-dimensional electron gas and you put it in a perpendicular magnetic field, these electrons of your electron gas start to circle around the magnetic field, and actually the area of this circle is quantized and gives rise to lambda levels. So these are these lambda levels now, and some will be filled up and some will be empty. So in a way, you can look at the lambda level structure as similar to an insulator. If the lambda level here is empty, and the valence band, if the other lambda level here is full. But there's something different in the quantum Hall from a boring insulator, and that is that there is this S channels that actually cause the quantized conductance in the quantum Hall effect. And these simply arise physically from electrons that make these skipping orders at the edges of the material, and they give rise to this edge channel which actually crosses the gap. And if you now have the Fermi energy in the gap, you see conductance through this edge channel. Now, this is a very simple way to explain this, but you can also look at this from a topological point of view. If you look at your mathematics, there's a paper by Toulas and others, this is why they got the Nobel Prize last year, that shows that actually you can characterize the band structure of this system by a novel type of quantum number, a so-called Chern number. And the Chern number in the quantum Hall effect is different from zero, and that actually leads to the fact that you have these type of excitations. So that actually was a first look into how you can actually handle these band structures, these condensed matter band structures, in a topological manner. And for experimenters like me, this was for a long time not very important because we had microscopic models. But what it is good for is that you can now think of ways to generalize the quantum Hall effect. And this has been going on in many directions for a long time until Charlie Kane and Eugene Melle actually came in this series of papers here, where they showed that, yes, you can define another topological quantum number, a Z2 topological quantum number, which is either zero in normal materials, but it's one. If it's one, it can be one, and they didn't really know when it's one. Then actually you again have edge channels in your material, but now it's zero field and they're spin full. And not only that, they cross the gap in this fashion, so they really make an X cross. They're Dirac-like, they're Dirac states in a condensed matter system. Now, as I said, they had an example of graphene with strong spin-orbit coupling in a weird manner, and that doesn't work in graphene because it has no spin-orbit coupling. And actually, it was after I met Xuching Zheng from Stanford, and I showed him our inverted band structure that we were talking about these things. And then we came to an understanding that yet the inversion is what you need to get your Z2 number equal to 1. And this is a way to look at it again. This is actually a top view on top of a hole bar, a mesa. And this is a cross-section of the energy levels. This is the conduction band and the valence band in a normal insulator, so without inversion. Basically, the conduction band, of course, has the same energy throughout your whole bar as seen before the valence band. But at the edges of your material, of course, there has to be, well, some type of band bending. You can call it electron affinity or whatever you like. But the carriers that are in your semiconductor like to stay there. They don't just pour out into vacuum. And since I have electrons here, this guy has to bend up. I have holes here, this guy has a band bending down. But look now at what happens if I have an inverted band structure. What you get now is that I have this conduction band, gamma 8 in my case, which in this topology is a conduction band, but in the outside world it's a valence band. This is a non-inverted topology. It bends down. The same thing here for this valence band, which at the edges all of a sudden realizes that in this other topology, it's a conduction band. It has to bend upwards. And what you get now, if you adjust the Fermi level in the gap of your material, is that you, at the edges of your material, you cross these dispersions. So you can make any finite energy excitation you like. That means you have a metal. And since these are actually spin-orbit split states, now you know that you have a system where you have a one-dimensional metal at the edges of your material, and because of the spin-orbit coupling, they're spin-polarized, and this is the quantum spin Hall effect. So that's the story in a nutshell of how all of this came to be. How do you measure it? Well, a first measurement is quite simple. If you make a small hole bar and you tune the Fermi level into the gap, now you have these edge channels, which actually are one-dimensional channels at the edges that cause conductance. And that means that there's a conductance remaining when the Fermi level is in the gap. And these are one-dimensional channels, so the conductance is 2e squared over h, one for spin up and one for spin down. And in a normal material, of course, if the Fermi level is in the gap, there's no conductance. So that's the simple experiment that you can do, and that's what we did more than 10 years ago now, and we indeed saw that if we have quantum wells with a wide quantum wells, we always see this conductance more or less quantized at 2e squared over h, and this is a narrow quantum well control sample, and you see there is no conductance anymore at all. At g is 1 over r. Well, there's lots of lithography with these samples. These are tricky materials. They're narrow gaps, so they don't like anything you do to them lithographically. We got a bit further a few weeks later, just using less exposure for our lithography process, and now we can scan all the way from N to P type. And actually, we are still working on it. This is more recent data where actually we do now do wet etching, and this gives us nicer edges to the sample, which is good if your edge channels are running there. But you see, we still have this quantization. So that's 2 DTIs, and well, 2 DTIs, of course, is, as I said, it's a generalization of the quantum Hall effect, but now you can do it without magnetic field. And the quantum Hall effect, of course, experimentally only exists in 2D because the third dimension you need your field. But if you now generalize without a magnetic field, it's a small step to say, well, if I have a three-dimensional material with band inversion, do I get a two-dimensional surface state on top of these sides of this material? And yes, that happens, and that's actually where the phrase topological insulator was coined. And you have it also in Merck Telluride, because we have this inversion here. So these are actually calculations of this surface state, and this is something actually I knew. This was known since the 80s, that you have these surface states in mercury telluride. They were predicted by people like Pankratov. So you see them here in the DFT calculation, and this is actually an ARPAS spectrum that was taken on our samples by ZX Shen's group in Stanford. Now, for a transport guide, this is still not that nice because we still have this material which has this gamma 8 touching, which means it's a semi-metal. And so if you want to do transport studies, you really want to open up a gap. And now we start to do some band structure engineering, as it's called. And what we do is we grow our samples on top of cadmium telluride, pure cadmium telluride, which is has a lattice constant which is larger than that of mercury telluride. And because of that, if you now grow an epi layer, you strain your unit cell, you distort it. And because you have this distortion, you have a different local symmetry. And now, again, the heavy and light state split up, as is shown here. And well, you have this surface state in your material, which is a bit complex in this case. It hybridizes again with the bulk states, but the blue lines are the dispersion of the topological surface state. And here's a quantum Hall effect taken from basically an anomaly insulating piece of 3D Merck telluride. We see a quantum Hall effect, and this was the first quantum Hall effect from a topological two-dimensional surface state in a three-dimensional material. You see these quantum Hall states. These are the top and bottom surface state of my semiconductor slab. Well, you can take this a bit further, you stick a gate on. And remember, I have this conducting state on the surface of the material. I found this amazing, because you put an oxide on, so you really destroy the crystallinity, and your surface state doesn't care. It just digs a bit deeper into your material, and it just sits there, and you get a beautiful quantum Hall effect as a function of gate voltage. Well, to analyze this a bit further, in the next plot, in the next slide, I'll show you V gate versus B, this data again, but now I just put a circle everywhere where I see a change in the quantum Hall quantization. And what you see then is that actually these experiments nicely line up in two Landau fans. And again, you can understand that what you do here simply by changing the gate voltage is that you vary the density in the top and the bottom surface state, and as a function of B field, you simply scan through the quantum Hall effect of these states. And we do this a bit better these days. Now we have a protective layer on top. The mobility is up by a factor of 20 or so, and now we can routinely actually scan the quantum Hall effect of these surface states from N to P type. Okay, let's change gear a little bit. Superconductivity, these are things that once you see that you can do things with topology that you couldn't do otherwise, you try to apply it in all kinds of directions. And a very interesting one is superconductivity. And what you would like to do is combine a topological band structure with superconductivity, and you expect exotic superconducting effects, novel types of pairing, novel bound states. Now, this is actually not something that's very trivial, because if you try to induce superconductivity in a semiconductor, you very often run into problems with band bending at the interface. We know this from 3.5s. Now, we got lucky here because mercury telluride is a 2.6, and these 2.6s don't have this band bending. So what we simply do in our devices is actually we make a small measure of mercury telluride. We contact with niobium strips on top of the material. You see that they're very close together, and we look for a supercurrent. And we see very robust supercurrents in these Josephson junctions. What you see here as a function of, well, you push the current here. So here I have a supercurrent in my device. You see there's no voltage drop for quite a range. There's a very robust superconductivity. And then you get out of the superconducting regime. And if you look at the high voltage behavior, you see that there are some asymptotes here. Well, there's the reason that you split that. But the asymptotes are important because they show you have something like something called Andreev reflection, which means that actually, indeed, you induce superconducting state or superconductivity in between the niobium junctions. You induce a new superconducting medium in your semiconductor material. And the other thing is that if you look a bit closer, you will see, well, you can't really see here, but in the differential data, you will see that there's inflection points at both the gap and twice the gap. And this is quite important because the signature at the gap here actually is a first indication that there might be an Andreev bound state at zero energy in these materials here. And again, this is a zero energy state. And this is very similar to what particle physicists think about zero energy states. That this is half electron, half hole. So in a way, this is a Majorana state. And this is what everybody is after in topological superconductivity, because this is something that could be very useful for quantum computing and things like that. Now, you would like to have some more evidence for this Majorana mode. You can look at the Fraunhofer pattern, which simply is a supercurrent as a function of applied magnetic field. And well, there's perhaps something, but not so very much that you can see. So we decided to do something else. We decided to go to high frequency measurement. And the reason is that there are, well, lots of experiences that the signatures for this zero mode are obscured by something called quasi-particle poisoning, which means that there's carriers jumping into your super region from other places, which basically change the parity and then make life difficult. And so if you measure faster than these processes, you should not be bothered too much by them. And so that's what we set out to do. This is a high-frequency experiment. What we want to see is this zero mode, and what you see here is actually the energy of these Andreev-bound states that you have between the niobium contacts in your semiconductor. These are trivial Andreev modes. You see the energy changes as a function of phase difference between your superconducting contacts, and this is something that you can impose. And the zero mode has a different dependence by a factor of 2 on the phase difference between these contacts. And this is something that you can try to tweak out with all kinds of RF experiments. And the one that we first started with is Shapiro response. Shapiro response is what happens if you have a Josephson junction, you irradiate with RF radiation. And if this RF radiation is compatible with the Josephson frequency, the high frequency, the AC Josephson frequency of your system, instead of a slope in your IV curve, you see a step. These are called Shapiro steps. And the idea that these people propose is quite simple, simply because you have this extra mode now in your response with a different frequency dependence, you will start losing odd steps in the Shapiro response, simply because of the different frequency they have here. And this is something we tried out first in these three-dimensional topological insulators, and you see that if you go to lower frequency, you see at high frequencies, we see all these Shapiro steps. Yeah, they're really there. Well, this is an old-fashioned experiment. That was no surprise. But you see if you go to low frequencies, the first step is gone. And this already, we tried to model. This is really a signature that you at least have 20% of Majorana mode contributing to your supercurrent. And things got even better when we went back to these two-dimensional systems. Well, the lithography is very hard now, but of course now you have more of this topological transport going on in your sample. So what we do now is we dig a hole in the cadmium telluride barrier of our quantum wells. We put aluminum in, and actually also we still can squeeze a gate in between these contacts, so we can really vary the Fermi level in between the contacts. And now the results of the Shapiro measurements, these are the bin plots that I showed previously, are even more pronounced. If you go to lower and lower frequency, you see that we not only missed the first step, we missed step number 3, step number 5, step number 7, we miss all steps up to number 9. So this is very convincing evidence that, at least in this case, we are dominated by the zero mode in our superconductivity. And yeah, a final experiment is a very recent one. If you think that these RF experiments are very complicated, there's a very simple way to do the same thing. Basically, bias your junction out of superconductivity and look at the Josephson radiation that comes from it. Well, this is not an easy experiment because this is all RF and you have to do it at millikelvin temperatures. But we found a relatively simple way to do it. We simply pick up the noise of our DC circuit with a bias T and amplify it, stick it in a spectrum analyzer. And the results were pretty spectacular. We really see in this topological quantum well basically dominating emission at half the gap, which is this zero mode. And in any test sample, we only see the full gap. Well, there's still some further things that to look into. What we do see is not only this zero mode behavior when the Fermi level is in the gap, we also see it when the Fermi level is in the conduction band. We think that actually even in the conduction band, these edge channels predominantly are responsible for the superconductivity because they have improved backscattering properties. So finally, the last few minutes, what we are doing right now, I already gave you an example of strain engineering. I showed you what happened if we went to larger lattice constants. It would also be nice to go to smaller lattice constants. The problem is there's no substrates for that, so you have to make those yourself, and this is a lot of work by the MBE growers in our lab. What we work with is actually a super lattice of cadmium telluride, which we grow on a gallium arsenide substrate. And now by simply changing the thickness of these layers in the super lattice, we can actually modify the strain from cadmium telluride strain to, which is tensile, to a very strong compressive strain. And what we can do now, for example, in these three-dimensional structures, I already mentioned that if you go to larger lattice constants, you pull these two gamma 8 bands apart and you open up a band gap. If you go to smaller lattice constants, you pull these gamma 8 bands through each other and you end up with two Dirac points. Actually, they're kind of split up by inversion asymmetry already present in the lattice, so these are more or less wild points. And we can show that we actually have this from something called a chiral anomaly. So again, this is where the particle physics come in. and what you see here, if there's a magnetic field in the plane of your sample, and this is very unusual, in the plane of the sample and you increase the magnetic field, you see a very strong negative magneto resistance. And you can only explain this, I won't go into details, if you indeed have this, well, this effect from particle physics present in the band structure in our materials here. You can see that if you rotate a magnetic field by 90 degrees in the plane, well, the effect is gone. The other nice thing is that in these materials, of course, we can gate. We have semiconductors, these are very clean semiconductors. So we can gate very nicely through the Dirac point with the Fermi level, and you see that this negative magneto resistance really only shows up when the Fermi level is at the Dirac point, which is where the resistance of the sample is largest. Okay, that brings me to the end of my talk. So I hope to have been able to bring you some of the fun that we have with these materials. We can really readily tweak mercury telluride in 2D and 3-dimensional topological insulators with very clear transport signs. The superconductivity is quite clearly topological. We really have the zero mode, and we're now trying to play further to see the spectroscopy of the zero mode, which should give us a very direct observation of a Majorana bound state in a condensed matter system. Thank you for your attention.